So it's a pleasure to welcome you again for today's seminar. And
yeah, thank you.
Okay, and our speaker today is Johanna, who is going to be back on our channel after 1 year. But now she's going to again talk about on the same topic of quantum information, gravity, and field theory. And she's going to report new works, new progress from Weir's group. So over to you, Johanna, now.
Yes, thank you very much. Thanks again for inviting me again. I have nice memories of my previous seminar, and we actually have quite a lot of new results, which I'll be very happy to tell you about. And so this is the overview of what I'm going to talk about. So it's about two different papers from this September with our Würzburg group. And so the first paper is about Berry phases in wormholes. And so this, I think I'm going to spend most of the time talking about this, also telling you about this collaboration. And the second paper is about quantum complexity as hydrodynamics, which is based on another paper with another group of people here in Würzburg. But I think, so I guess I have something like 55 minutes. So I think most of the time I will actually be talking about this one, and then we see how far we are going to get here. Okay, let me start with project number one, which is about Berry phases in wormholes and in quantum mechanics. And so this is about a project which you can see here. First of all, I should mention that Shobhik Banerjee, who's in the audience, is actually one of the authors. And so quite a few of the ideas are due to him in this talk, in this project. And I should also mention that this project is funded by a joint funding initiative of a quite large scale. I don't know if you are familiar with science funding in Germany, but there's the so-called Excellence Initiative, where we get money from the federal government. And so there's the so-called Excellence Cluster involving, I think, about 200 scientists from all countries working in both Würzburg, where I'm now, and also in Dresden. And so this joint scale, large scale initiative is called Complexity and Topology in Quantum Matter. So it's really more about solid state physics, quantum information. However, there's also quite a bit of holography that is funded in the context of this network. And so you see that as affiliations, you see this Würzburg Dresden Cluster of Excellence, CTQMAT. And so this project is actually a joint project with us here in Würzburg, together with two condensed matter physicists from Dresden, Flavio Nogueira and Jeroen van den Brink, both of whom are at this Institute for Theoretical Solid State Physics in Dresden. And so I think it's a very nice interdisciplinary project involving both gravity aspects and also quantum mechanics aspects. So I'm going to tell you about this, and actually I will start with quite a bit about quantum mechanics, outlining the central ideas of this project. And then the second part will then be to see how all these concepts can also be realized in wormhole physics. Okay, I should mention that apart from Shobhik, there is also our very good student Moritz Dorband involved, as well as my colleague René Meyer, whom you probably know. And so let me start with a quick overview about what Berry phases actually are. So they're really actually mathematical concepts, but they have very important applications, mostly in condensed matter physics, but also many other areas of physics. And I mean, since it's a mathematical concept, it can be explained in quite simple terms in a simple physics example. And here I pick an example as presented in these beautiful lectures by David Tong about the quantum Hall effect. And so the starting point for defining this Berry phase is the time-dependent Schrödinger equation given here, where the Hamiltonian depends on some parameter lambda, which itself is a function of t. And now consider that we have a ground state for this Hamiltonian that can be obtained as a unitary operator acting on some basis of, so the ground state is run by some basis. And so you have a unitary transformation taking you to this ground state here. And Then we can define the so-called Berry connection, which formally looks like a gauge field because it's like a connection in general relativity, which makes derivatives covariant. And so this connection is defined as the derivative of this basis states with respect to the various parameters. So assuming we have several of these parameters lambda, and then taking the expectation in this particular way. Now, inserting this into the Schrödinger equation then tells you that this unitary transformation satisfies this differential equation here. And so using this connection, we may now define the so-called Berry phase as a path order exponential, essentially, of a curved, a closed curve integral over this connection in the parameter space and as given here. Now, a very simple example, which will turn out to be useful later on, is just to look at one single spin in a spin a half particle interacting with a magnetic field. So you just have a coupling S times V, scalar product S times V. And then actually it turns out that the Berry connection will have this structure that you can see here. It will correspond actually to a magnetic monopole, but it's not a magnetic monopole in real space. Rather, it's, you know, as a second level of abstraction, it's a magnetic monopole actually in the space spanned by the B field. Okay, so it's a monopole in the space spanned by the magnetic field. But so then you can already see that there's a singular point, namely the origin. And so this is where this second order magnetic monopole actually sits. And so this is like having a point charge. And so this means that actually here there's a singular point here. And these singular points, they will show up quite a bit later and will play an important role. Okay, so just a reminder for everybody what the Berry phase is. And so let me now give you an outline of this first part of the talk. So I'm going to consider this Berry phase that I presented to you for a very simple case of just one spin a half particle in a magnetic field. I will look at this also in quantum mechanics, but in a slightly more complicated system, which is an interacting two qubit system. So not just one, but two qubits in quantum mechanics. And so by looking at this interacting system, we will actually find the result that states with the same entanglement, so the same entanglement entropy, the same density matrix, or say a density matrix changing in a very simple way, such that the entanglement entropy is unchanged. So states with the same entanglement may nevertheless have a different Berry phase. So there's a possibility of distinguishing between quantum states with the same entanglement and properties by this topological quantity, the Berry phase. So, and mathematically, this is described by a non-exact symplectic form. And so this non-exact symplectic form in the simple example that I showed you on the previous slide is actually due to a singular point similar to this origin here in this example that I discussed here. And so now, since we have this collaboration with Konrad's matter physicist, an essential feature of this structure in quantum mechanics is that this structure that I'm presenting to you may actually be probed experimentally. And our colleagues made some suggestions how this can actually be achieved. But then from a kind of more holography gravity perspective, we will see that actually wormholes can share this same mathematical structure. And so there's a very, very interesting analogy between the geometry of the Hilbert space of the simple quantum mechanics system with certain entanglement properties on one hand side, and on the other side, the Hilbert space for the effective field theory describing the wormhole. Okay, I should say, if you have any questions, please interrupt me at any time. So, okay, let me go on by saying that why we are interested in actually looking at these Berry phase for wormholes And of course, it's clear in the context of holography and so on that there's these very, very beautiful proposals by, considered by many, many authors in the last, say, 10 years about the relation between entanglement and geometry, as it's provided, for instance, in the ADS-CFT correspondence. And I think most of you will be familiar with this, but I will come back to a particular example, the ER's EPR conjecture, and later in this talk. And so our work is also very much motivated by some recent work of Hermann Verlinde, who actually discussed that the concept of a wormhole is also present in simple quantum mechanics systems. And certainly our work builds a lot on this idea that he proposed earlier this year. And so actually the very phase will provide an understanding of how the degrees of freedom entangle to give the full Hilbert space in the quantum mechanical system, or equivalently in the effective field theory for the wormholes. And so an important term which comes about is the term of factorization. So if we have two spins, two qubits, this is very similar to having both the left and right hand side, if you want, of a wormhole, so the two throats of the wormhole. And so the question is, do the Hilbert spaces associated with these individual spins or wormholes factorize or not? And we will see very clearly in the quantum mechanical example what the difference between a factorized and a non-factorized geometry is. Okay, so let me look at a very particular model in quantum mechanics. So this model is about coupled spins in an external magnetic field, as is, for instance, realized by the electronic Zeeman interaction in a hydrogen atom, which means that we consider this Hamiltonian here. So here, the J is a coupling between the two spins. So assume we have two spin and half fields with spin and half operators given by the Pauli matrices. And so we have these two spin operators interacting with each other. And then we assume that one of them is actually also coupled to a magnetic field. So this means, for instance, we consider the, in the hydrogen atom, we consider the magnetic moment for the electron, but we disregard the interaction between the proton spin and the magnetic field. Okay, so this term here is not written in bold, because this is just a product of functions here. However, we can consider the following case, that we generalize the second term to a full scalar product with two vectors. And then we ask the question, well, how do we return from this general interaction to the case where they actually parallel to each other, as was written here? Well, to return to this original term, we have to consider particular unitary transformations, which bring us back to this original Zeeman term. And in particular to this first spin, we then have to apply a unitary transformation, which will depend on two angle variables, phi and theta. And so in the most general transformation that you can write down, to which brings any of these products back to this form written up here, looks like this. So we have e to the minus I phi s1z, e to the minus I theta s1y. And then there's a third time a term again involving s1z. And here now I wrote a more general angle psi. And the reason for this is that there's actually now two different coordinate patches, if you want the north and the south pole of our S2 sphere associated with this SU2 symmetry. So and then one patch psi has to be equal to phi. And in the other one it has to be, there has to be a minus sign in this relation here. To bring this term back to that one here. Okay, and so this is the unitary transformation that we may apply to the first spin. And then of course we may also apply other unitary transformations to the second spin. And since the second spin doesn't appear in this magnetic term here, we can choose anything, any union termite transformation we like that acts on the second spin. And for instance, we can take the second transformation to be equal to the first one, with the difference that it acts only on the second spin, not on the first spin. And for instance, we can take a parameter lambda between 0 and 1, which multiplies these angles here. This lambda will be very important and come back quite a few times later in the talk. So remember, it's just a parameter which changes these angles between the two unitary transformations acting on the two sides on these two different spin operators. And then, of course, we have a global or a total, a total unitary transformation, which is the tensor product of these two U1 and U2. Okay. So now we can calculate the ground state of our Hamiltonian, so of this Hamiltonian, and calculate its entanglement entropy. And actually, since now we have two coupled spin, we're going to use a right basis where we write this in terms of the angular momentum and magnetic quantum numbers. So we have singlet and striplet states. So S can be either 0 or 1, and M can be then correspondingly either 0 or +1, 0 and -1. And so then it turns out that the ground state takes this form here, which involves the zero component of the triplet state and the singlet state. And this alpha is a fixed parameter, which is fixed by the magnetic field. So the mode of the magnetic field, and also by this coupling, which is here at the front. And so now actually it turns out that the entanglement entropy is not changed when applying the unitary transformation that I just introduced and that acts on each of the spins individually. Okay, so if we calculate the entanglement entropy for each of the two spins by tracing over the other, then by applying any of these unitary transformations, the entanglement entropy is unchanged. And we can actually calculate the entanglement entropy, and it's the result is given here in terms of this parameter alpha defined by this equation here. Okay, you might say, well, due to the cyclicity of the trace, this is absolutely trivial, but it's a little more complicated because there's only a partial trace, but nevertheless, it's pretty straightforward to show that this relation holds. Okay, so now let me look at the Berry phase in a slightly more mathematical way than I was doing before, because then I can explain. So the upshot will be that these states which have the same entanglement entropy will nevertheless have a different Berry phase. And I'm going to now formulate it in slightly more mathematical language, because that will be actually useful. So we are aiming for wormholes. Okay, so the goal is to talk about wormholes. And before we reach there, I'm going to introduce a slightly more mathematical formalism, which will then allow us to directly apply an analog of this formalism to the wormhole case. Okay, so now in mathematical terms, it's actually useful to define the so-called Maurer-Cartan form. And that's a connection on a group manifold M, and which can be defined for any group element sigma. And here you see the definition of this Maurer-Cartan form. And the Berry connection that I already introduced in a simple example earlier is then the ground state expectation value of this Maurer-Cartan form. So here you see our connection. This is given by this expectation value. And in our case now, this group element is this unitary transformation U that I introduced before. And here now we can just explicitly insert our ground state and also insert the unitary transformation. And then the result is actually this equation here. And now you see something interesting, because essentially this result depends on this parameter lambda. So lambda was a parameter which distinguishes between the left and the right hand part of the unitary transformation. And so you see the result for the Berry connection, and correspondingly also the Berry curvature, which is given by this expression here, depends on this lambda. And in particular, we see if lambda is equal to one, which means that the two spin operators are kind of rotated in phase, then actually the Berry curvature vanishes. But in all other cases, it doesn't. It's a non-trivial result. And also, and then we also see for every lambda, we have a different Berry curvature, although all these states will actually have the same entanglement entropy. And from this result, the definition here involves the so-called Kirillov-Kostand symplectic form, which is just essentially the exterior derivative of the Maurer-Cartan form. So that's another useful quantity that we define here. So from this Berry curvature, we can calculate the Berry phase, which is defined as the integral over over this form here. And so here again, we see the Berry phase result here, with this property that it vanishes when lambda is equal to one, but it's non-zero if lambda is different from one. Okay, so here I just summarized what I just said. So the Berry phase is non-trivial as long as lambda is not equal to one, which means that the two unitary transformations acting on the left and right hand side should be different. And in fact, it's non-trivial because this Kirillov-Kostand symplectic form is not globally exact. It's a form which is proportional to the volume form of S2. And so this is singular in a very related way as in this simple, very simple example that I showed you at the beginning for just one spin. So there's a kind of magnetic monopole, if you want. And this implies that.
Johanna, can I ask something here? Yeah. So this unitary transformation necessarily has to always work, act on one of the spins, so that.
Let me show it again. Yes. So it has this form, this general form. Okay. So the unitary transformation, right, you choose some parameters that you like. For this transformation, which acts only on spin one. Okay. And then you choose a different transformation which only acts on spin two. But for the parameter values, you take the angles just multiplied by this lambda. And then the entire unitary transformation is amounts to this tensor product here.
Okay, so this is still a kind of local unitary, what people call local.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. But we will see very shortly that there's some local, non-local and non-factorization structures that will emerge. I mean, that's kind of the upshot of what I want to show you. Yeah, very good point.
And basically, you're also thinking about the Schmidt basis doesn't change. It's not only the entanglement entropy, the Schmidt basis also, if you're tracing out one of them, the Schmidt basis will also not change.
Yeah, that's a good point. I should say though that at the moment I'm talking about Berry phase. I mean, you know, you can also define a Berry phase with respect to the Schmidt basis, but here
that's exactly what I was going to ask, whether the Berry phase is respect to the
Schmidt basis. But I think this is an important point. Thanks for asking a very important question. The important point is that we define the Berry phase with respect to this magnetic field. Okay, it's also possible to define a different Berry phase with respect to the Schmidt decomposition, but I think for what I'm going to show you here, we have to actually have this magnetic field present. I think I will come back to this point, but for now, just remember I consider a Berry phase with respect to this magnetic field, which is different from the one in this Schmidt Schmidt sphere that you have in mind. So it's really a Berry phase, you know, very down to earth Berry phase with respect to a magnetic field that is there in some lab. All right, and this brings me to quantum tomography. So Lata, I think you are in the audience. Hi Lata, nice to see you. I saw your very nice review.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was going to get in touch with you about this now. Sorry, I was super busy. I didn't get yet. So Lata has written a very beautiful review about this, so which I recommend. Okay, so I'm not an expert. I will just tell you very briefly. So So there is an experimental method which is called quantum tomography, and I think the standard, as our condensed matter colleague told us, this is the standard reference for a review of this. And the idea is to, you could now actually measure, or the suggestion is to really measure in a lab this fact that we have states with same entanglement entropy but different Berry phase. And so to reconstruct the density matrix, one can use this method of quantum tomography, which means that a quantum state is reconstructed using measurements on an ensemble of identical quantum states. And so this here is actually taken from some email that Lato's colleague from Innsbruck, Andreas Elben, sent to me, so another expert in quantum tomography, that it's actually possible to actually measure phases by measuring tensor products of Pauli matrices of this type, and that will allow us to reconstruct the phase, so the quantum phase in the ground state. Okay, so but then of course the measurements which one would need to do a little more involved, because in addition to measuring the density matrix, one would now also have to measure the Berry phase with respect to this magnetic field. Okay, so that's a bit more challenging. And so our condensed matter colleagues, they came up with some proposals for experiments. So the idea is that simultaneous measurement of the Berry phase and the entanglement involves measuring interference between original and rotated state for an ensemble of identical quantum states. But our colleagues, they have proposed quite a series where this could be done. So one is the hydrogen atom in a magnetic field that I was just talking about. There's also a possibility of doing liquid state NMR, or to look at quantum dots coupled to optical cavities, and also superconducting quantum circuits. So this is a group of proposals where it would be potentially possible to actually quantum mechanically measure this situation, that there's a state, or there's a class of states which all have the same entanglement entropy, but nevertheless have a different Berry phase with respect to this magnetic field. Okay, so it's quite nice that we have this really down to earth connection to the real world. And now I'm going to go for quite far away from the real world, first to mathematics and then to wormholes, but it will be very interesting to see that the structure that we will see there will be very, very similar to what I explained to you so far.
Johanna, can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
That I just was wondering, you said that the term S1C is due to the coupling with the experiment. So I was just wondering if you also have a proposal about how to, what should be these unitaries U1 and U2, because they are there for a specific purpose of aligning B and SG.
Yeah, I mean, so the unitaries, we define them in such a way as to have this alignment, but so you can just look at these definitions of U1 and U2, and so the idea is that every quantum state obtained by applying this unitary transformation will lead to a state which this still has the same entanglement entropy, but the Berry fields will change. I mean it's just a way of constructing this, and that's the physical properties that these transformations will have.
Thanks.
Okay, now we want to make a connection to this, what Arjan alluded to, the concept of factorization versus non-factorization. And for this, we now go to another level of abstraction and look at this in a slightly more mathematical terms. So, and by actually writing the spin now in this CP1 representation, so with sigma again the Pauli matrix, so we introduce these two complex variables and decompose the spin operator in such a way, which then leads to, these span a CP1 state. So, the full Hilbert space now in this language will be a CP3 state. So this is represented by this blue ellipsoid here. And so now if we have two factorized states, then, you know, with each a single qubit, then these two subspaces, they would correspond to a CP1 state each. So, and then you can actually make a product state by just taking a tensor product of both of these two CP1 states. Now, if the magnetic field vanishes, then the ground state of the system indeed lies inside the CP1 times CP1 subspace and describes local properties, so one-sided properties. However, now if we turn on this magnetic field, then this tensor product structure is broken, and actually the ground state will be non-diagonally embedded in. So in the ground state will lie in a non-diagonally embedded submanifold of CP3. I think I have a little more about this. Yeah, so without going into too many details, so in fact, if you have this non-zero Berry connection, then we are the state is in the system in the ground, or the ground state is outside this factorized ground subspace, and so this can be seen as follows. So the CP3s can be written as a coset space of a SU4 group quotiented by a U3. And then there's the U1 factor inside this U3, which defines a U1 bundle. And then the bundle connection is given by the Maurer-Carton form of SU4 in analogy. So I defined this Maurer-Carton before for the more simpler case. And so then we pick this group element here, which is associated to this U1 bundle. And then define the Berry connection using this equation here. And so the important point is now that this generator does not act block diagonally. And so this first of all, so as I said, the ground state of the system is then no longer in the CP1 times CP1. It's really in a non-factorized ground state subspace. And also this Kirillov-Poisson symplectic form will no longer be exact. Okay, so there's a relation between the theory not factorizing and the symplectic form not being exact. So this is an important mathematical.
Sorry, and how does it relate to the earlier example that you discussed?
It's exactly the same. It's just written in slightly more complicated mathematical root terms. I mean, So we write our spin operator that we were discussing before in the CP1 language and look at the spaces spanned by these variables. Then we have two of these spins, and then, you know, if we have then two of these spins, this spans a CP3 space, and then we just define the Maurer-Carton form with respect to the Z1 bundle, and. So then that gives the same mathematical. If you really calculate this A now, this will give exactly the same result as before.
Okay. I see. So the state is not a factorized state. That's a very important point
Yes, exactly. So that's the really crucial point. The ground state is not in this factorized subspace. And the reason for introducing the CP1 or CP3 picture is because then this can be really seen explicitly. Okay, so the state is just not in the subspace anymore. Okay, so the point of the complex reactive mathematical explanation is just to show the non-factorization of the ground state. Okay, and since now we talk about non-factorization, that brings us directly to wormholes. Okay. So now we will change gears and, okay, so I talked for a long time about quantum mechanics. Now let's talk about wormholes, but okay, let's talk about simple wormholes also in this small amount of dimensions, 1+1 dimensions. And so here we follow this analysis of Fallende from this very nice paper from May 21. Okay, so he considers wormholes in quantum mechanics. And consider some thermal quantum system which has a partition function that looks like this. And then assume that we can write this quantum mechanical system in a kind of abstract form in phase space. Okay, so assume that we have a phase space which is spanned by generalized coordinates and momenta, which are called xa. Then this is just some fact from classical mechanics. We can associate it as symplectic form omega to this phase space. Okay, so that's something about dynamics of classical mechanical systems, which is well known. And then it turns out that in general, the partition function can be written as in a partial integral representation, where you have here one integral over the disk. So the disk is, so this boundary of the disk is again the thermal circle. So it's the Euclidean time, which is compactified to give you a temperature. Okay, so that's the standard finite temperature field theory circle. And the disk has this additional structure here. And so in general, there's a partial integral representation of the partition function, which looks like this. Now, if the symplectic structure is exact, this means then we can write the form as an exterior derivative of some other form. And then by Stokes' theorem, we can use this relation here. And then in that case, this integral just returns to a standard one-dimensional integral over this thermal circle. However, if the symplectic structure is non-exact, then the partition function is given by this entire path integral here, which involves an integral in one dimension higher. Okay. So this you can repeat for kind of wormholes with many legs. So this already gives you some wormhole-like structure by just looking at these surfaces that enter these partition functions. So here, for instance, you can also have a multi-throat wormhole. And again, if the symplectic structure is non-exact, then you get a kind of connected region in your, as an integration service in the path integral. Sorry. Okay. So then maybe you see already a little bit the connection to what we were doing before. So now the next point is that we can tie this together with entanglement. And so there we consider the famous ERS EPR setup as proposed by Malaszina and Suskin in 2013. So now assume we have an ADS2 space, which is drawn here. And we use global coordinates. It means there is one quantum mechanical system here on the right-hand side and one quantum mechanical system on the left-hand side. And so this is the horizon. These are the singularities and time moves in this direction. And so then the proposal here in this ERS EPR proposal is that if we consider a so-called thermofield double state as is written here, then we have one set of one basis of states on the right hand side and one basis of states on the left hand side, and so they if they're linked by a geodesic here in this dual picture, then we will have a state of maximum entanglement. Okay, so saying this once more, we look at some global ADS2 Schwarzschild metric. So this is an eternal black hole in ADS, which is non-traversable. Okay, so everything I'm going to say here is about non-traversable wormholes. And so one important aspect that will show up to be relevant soon is that there will be no globally defined time parameter. And so then if we have this thermofield double state defined in this way, where we have an anti-Hermitian operator relating the two, and this is defined in such a way that if you trace over one of them, you get a thermal density matrix for the other one, the other system again. Then we have this thermofield double state, which is realized in this geometrical picture here. So there's a relation between entanglement and this geometrical picture. Now, let me draw this wormhole in a slightly more science fiction inspired way, as you can see here. Okay, so I just added one dimension to the picture, but in principle it's the same, exactly the same picture as the one on the previous page. And so I assume there's some flat space time, and there's the two ends of the wormhole here, located here. Then here, since we here we have a flat space time, if we identify times here at this boundary line, it's quite natural to identify the time of the left region with the one of the right region. I mean, here we are just in flat space, there's nothing which abstracts us from just identifying these two times. But now note that since we have a black hole horizon here from this ADS structural geometry, actually the horizon means that at this point the scalar product respect to time is not well defined, and actually the time that Killing vector jumps here. So, and we have to take to into account this jump, and so this will be given by adding another time parameter, a time jump, if you want, here at the horizon. So at the horizon, one has to be careful how to identify the time, and a choice which takes into account this jump is given by this equation here. And okay, so in this delta will play a very crucial role in what follows. So if we do both these identification, then it really means that left and right time and also delta, they all have to take the same values at the boundaries. Okay, so, and actually there's now, there's a symmetry associated with the gauge renum in the TFD state. We can have a time evolution on this side and a time evolution on that side. So in fact, the two times go, T left and T right go in opposite direction on the two boundaries. So if we apply a U1 time evolution transformation, then this geodesic changes like this, but actually this is just the symmetry of the problem. Okay, so there's essentially just a gauge freedom which amounts to these U1 transformations on these two sides of the wormhole. Okay, and so there's a lot of detail here. Maybe I should jump to the important point. So here again, I have written this thermal field double state, which is realized by the two bases of the quantum mechanical systems on the two sides. And this phase freedom, which I just alluded to, which comes from the symmetry on the two boundaries, amounts to a phase here in this anti-Hermitian operation. And so there's a generalized TFD state that we can define with parameter alpha, where for all the energy levels of the states on the two sides, we introduce a phase here. And it turns out that this phase is actually related to this delta parameter, which I gave you beforehand in this way. So, and now we have a very
similar. Can I ask something, Johanna?
Yeah, sure.
So this phase can be absorbed in the definition of this basis states, or is it that you have in mind the phase will ultimately give rise to this?
Well, it can be absorbed, but I don't think I want to do that, because I want to make use of the symmetry for having a unitary transformation. You see, I want to realize exactly the same structure as in the quantum mechanical system that I discussed before. And so the claim is that the U1 transformation that we have there, or the unitary transformation that we have there, amounts now in this case to this phase transformation here. Okay, I should be a little careful, because you know the symmetries are a bit different, but I mean, just take this as a unitary transformation as we had in the quantum mechanical example. And then I can again see that we have a non-factorized structure in the Hilbert space. Okay, so, and in that way, I want to realize an analogy to the previous example. Okay, so these phases do not change the entanglement entropy, because the reduced density matrix of either side is unchanged, okay, because it's just a phase, and then it just disappears when calculating the density matrix. And so again, we have a class of states that capture the same entanglement properties. Okay, And now we can look at the time evolution and take delta and the sum of the two Hamiltonians on the two sides as the phase space variables. And keeping in mind that the difference of the Hamiltonians actually acts trivially on the sum of your double state. And so then I can write a phase space transformation. So I get this phase transformed sum of your double by acting with this operator on the original sum of your double state. Okay, and now we can actually associate a very phase with the wormhole, making use of the fact that the transformation U actually acts differently on each of the boundaries. And then again, we can calculate the Berry connection in the phase space, which now takes this form here, where we use this phase space variable, this given by this time jump delta. And then just inserting the definition of the sum of your double state and this transformation, we get some expression here. And okay, and the structure is actually now very similar to what we had before. If we do the same transformation on both sides, then the Berry phase vanishes. But if we change them individually, then with the different phase, then also the Berry phase is going to be non-zero. And okay. So for the different morphism where we have a sum of the two Hamiltonians, we do get a non-zero Berry phase. And well, okay, I should be a little careful here. At the moment, I'm just talking about the Berry connection, really. Okay, I have to still tell you about the orbit along which we want to integrate this. On the other side, if we take this different morphism, then already the Berry connection vanishes. Okay, and then also the Berry phase will vanish. And this is a very, very similar structure. So the upshot of the talk is that I want to show this very general structure as in the quantum mechanics model. Okay, and then we, to conclude here, so we actually calculate this wormhole Berry phase for the JT gravity, which is a famous for this famous Jacques Teitelbaum two-dimensional gravity model with a scalar field. And so the analysis of the Hamiltonian is already given in this paper here, but we used it to obtain the Berry phase. And a natural integration path is now this along this green line here. And so first of all, we see that now this has a non-trivial topology, but also importantly, the symplectic form has a singularity at this point here. And so then if we calculate the Berry phase in this JT gravity, we do get 2 pi, which then corresponds to a winding number in this geometry. Okay, and essentially, so the upshot is, the mathematical structure is identical in the two systems, for the wormholes and also for the quantum mechanical system, because so we have in each time we have a class of states with the same entanglement entropy but different Berry phase, and this shows up here in this geometrical picture, but also in the quantum mechanical Hilbert space as I discussed in quite some detail at the beginning. All right, so time is running fast. I wanted to tell you about this other project as well, but okay, so Ayan, do you have 5 more minutes?
Yeah, sure. We have 5 more minutes, definitely.
Yeah, okay, this will certainly not be enough for the second project. Let me just give you an upshot of what we have done there, okay? So, let's change gear a little bit. But again, it will be about quantum mechanics and relations to holography. And so in that paper, we have studied quantum complexity. I guess everybody here is familiar with complexity. So this is a concept from information theory of how many unitary transformations are necessary to obtain a final state from a reference state up to a tolerance. Okay, so and this is a well-known concept from quantum information theory, but now there's also a lot of interest in, because Susskind made these proposals that there's gravity dual realizations of this for black holes using the volume or the action of the black hole space-time. And so now there's quite a field in in ADS-CFT. I think that's what I also talked quite a bit about when I gave my talk last year. So the idea is that one would like to define this in quantum field theories rather than in finite dimensional Hilbert spaces as used in by the quantum information community. And so the project that we have here is a bit complementary to what I talked about in my last talk, which was about realizing complexity using conformal gates in conformal field theory. But here we stay in the quantum mechanical context. And so there's this famous Nielsen approach, which is the basis of many investigations now of complexity also in quantum field theory, which was originally proposed by Nielsen for, say, Hilbert spaces with spinor half systems. And in view of making contact to systems of relevance in holography, we have considered a large N limit. So in this case, we have just looked at one single Q dit. So we look at a generalization of a qubit, which has N components. Okay. And then take the number n to be infinite. And okay, so that's a complementary extension to extending the Nielsen approach to quantum field theory, because it's still a quantum mechanical system, but it has an analysis of this large n limit. And okay, I probably don't have time to go into all the details. So this Nielsen approach, which has been around for since 2005, I think, is the statement here. So the complexity, so this is a statement proven by a mathematician for finite dimensional Hilbert spaces. So the complexity is the smallest geodesic distance from the identity to some desired unitary, which gives rise to this new state in the Hilbert space. So that's drawn in this picture here. And so the unitary is defined by some particular control Hamiltonian. Again, there's a Schrödinger equation with some boundary conditions. And then to define the length function, one has to introduce the cost function, which is this F here. And then there's a minimization procedure involved. So, and the proposal by Nielsen is that the complexity is the minimum of the length functional over all controller Hamiltonians obeying the particular chosen boundary conditions. Okay, so I don't think I have time to go into all the details, but so what we did is to generalize this approach to qdits. Qdit is an object with d or n components, and then we considered the large n limit. And there's a relation to the so-called Euler-Arnold approach, because so Arnold suggested that it's so famous mathematician from already 50 years ago, that geodesics can be computed from the time evolution of the algebra elements. And so there's this famous Euler-Arnold equation that you see here, so which then determines the evolution of this control Hamiltonian. And so that corresponds to the geodesics obtained from the evolution of these nine Lie algebra elements. Okay, and without going into many details, we found an interesting connection to hydrodynamics in the large N limit, because in the large N limit, actually the algebra satisfied by SUN reduces considerably. And actually it turns out that the algebra of the Hamiltonian vector fields, so control Hamiltonian vector fields associated to this SUN, actually give the Euler equation for a fluid flow on a torus, on a two torus. Okay, so the solutions to the hydrodynamical Euler equation, so no viscosity, no friction, for this fluid flow on the torus satisfies precisely again this algebra. Okay, and so I don't have time to explain this in detail, but what we found is that there's a very intricate large N limit. Okay, so the reason for doing is also to study the ergodicity properties of this flow and you know, understand whether there's relations to the complexity properties that are discussed for black holes again. the key upshot of what I want to say is that actually there's probably a very non-trivial, non-linear behavior in the exact large n limit. Okay. The reason being,
so just one clarification, Johanna. So you mean that the optimal path, the optimal gates will follow the fluid lines on the torus?
Yes, exactly. That's right. Yeah, I mean, yeah. So the equation of motion for the vector fields of this flow are exactly the same as the Euler-Arnold equation for this SUN algebra. Okay, so. Now, what one ideally wants for comparison with complexity in ADS CFT is to have a majority of so-called negative sectional curvatures. Okay, so you want the curves to diverge in phase space. And my collaborators they set up a numerical program to calculate them these curvatures in this group manifold for different values of n. And another geometrical feature that's important is are these so-called conjugate points. So to keep a long story short, on one hand side, one wants a majority of negatively curved directions, but not all of them should be negative. There should be a small amount of positive curvature directions as well, because the complexity should kind of stop growing at late times. And so, I mean, this is just the intuition from the black hole side of the correspondence. Okay, so I wanted to see if this can be realized. And the upshot is that, for finite values of n, we see that there's a majority. So here you see different values of n that we looked at. And here are these curvatures along the group manifold directions. And then essentially this converges to some values here. Okay, I mean, up to 39 as far as we got. And so one sees that there's a majority of positively curved directions. Okay. However, as we just realized a few days ago, and will come in a second version of the paper, something very non-trivial is expected to happen in the strict large n limit. Okay, and in fact, let me just say that one has to be extremely careful in which order the limits are taken. Okay, because in this algebra there were these vectors here. Let me just show this quickly. Okay, so here this is the algebra that we have for SUN, where M and N are some particular vectors that are shown in this figure here. Okay, so here this is just writing a basis for SUN in suitable basis. And so there's these vectors M and N, which are integers that appear here in these definitions here. Okay, and they can be drawn in such a lattice for M and N. And there's a modular symmetry and so on. And so these vectors M and N, they also enter in the algebra here. And so in this naive and large N limit that I discussed before, one considers the case that these are of order one compared to N. And then of course, the sign can be just expanded in the first term. And then one obtains this large N hydro algebra. But one has to be a little careful because these vector M and N, they can also be of order N. And by really taking the limit in the correct order, one sees that there's really in the explicit large N limit, there's a totally different behavior. So it's, I mean, here it looks like if you follow these lines to infinity, they will just asymptote to a constant. But what we now find is that this is actually not the case. By being very careful, then we actually we obtain this hydrodynamic behavior only in this limit where first we take the strict large n limit and not all of these vectors contribute anymore. Okay, this is a little subtle. if you want, I can explain a little more in the discussion if this is of interest, but in view of time, I would just leave it here by saying, okay, there's a very set, subtle order of limits which has to be taken into account. And the upshot will be that in the strict large n limit, there will be a totally different behavior than just by naively extrapolating to large values of n. And I think this is of interest for comparing this Nielsen approach with these black hole complexity definitions. Okay, let me just summarize for now, and I'm happy to discuss more if you want. So I showed you two recent projects of our group. The first one on which I spent quite some time was about Berry phases for wormholes and in quantum mechanics. There's a striking similarity between the black wormhole physics and the quantum mechanical model, although the quantum mechanical model is of course weakly coupled. Okay, so it's not a duality in the original sense of ADS-CFT, but nevertheless, there's a very beautiful analogy here. And what we are doing at the moment is to generalize this idea to higher dimensions. Okay, then I didn't have a lot of time, but so we also have a nice project on obtaining quantum complexity as hydrodynamics in this by extending the Nielsen approach to qubits and considering the limit of infinitely many components. But all this analysis that I showed you, this intricate large n limit, really involves that that we just so far considered one single qubit. But of course, if we want to make any connection to quantum field theory, at least we should look at lattices of many of these qubits, which would be an obvious generalization. Okay, I see I planned for far too many things, so I will have to come back yet for another talk in the not too distant future, if I may, and let me leave it there for now. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah. Thanks for the great talk, Johanna. So we should take up some questions now. Or I'll just have some discussion.
Hi, Ayal.
Hi, nice to see you.
So yeah, this is not, hi, Johanna. This is not a question as such, but just a comment. I think Brian Swingle has done some work on an effective hydrodynamic theory of scrambling.
Okay, very good. Mm-hmm.
So you know, that may or may not have a relationship with the picture that you're presenting.
Thank you for this very interesting remark. I'm not aware of this, but I should definitely take a look because I do think there's a possibility of relating this. Yeah, that's a very good point. Yeah, thanks for pointing this out. I haven't thought about this, but it seems like an excellent idea. Yeah, thanks.
Okay. So, further questions? Okay. I have some questions actually for the first part of your talk.
Yeah, sure.
So it doesn't matter really whether the wormhole is traversable or not, right? In your
good question. Okay. Yes, I mean definitely the geometry we considered so far it's a non-traversable one. And really, so the upshot is that we need this non-exact symplectic form. And that really comes from the singularity at the Killing horizon, or I shouldn't say singularity, but this non-trivial behavior of the time-like Killing vector at the black hole horizon. So for this, I can make a definite statement. So of course, it's conceivable that this also holds for traversable wormholes, but okay, I mean, to be really conservatively honest, we haven't looked at this and I'm not exactly sure how this generalizes, but you know, I agree with you, it's very conceivable that we have a similar behavior in that case.
So, so you think that there could be a, I mean, what mode this Berry phase actually tells us, I mean, what kind of structure it reveals that we couldn't have got from, say, from just by looking at this mutual entanglement or some other stuff, right?
Yeah, okay. So it's just because, let me just show the geometry again.
Because non-factorization itself is a part of the entanglement, right?
Yes, that's right. I mean, there's definitely non-factorization. I'm just not, I think this is independent of whether the wormhole is traversable or not. I mean, so in the simple geometry that we looked at here, I mean, it's really, the killing, so time runs in this, here time runs in this direction and here time runs in that direction, or the other way around, or the time here like this and here like that. But this means, of course, that at this point, there's a really similar behavior, and so that's why you can't get, I mean, you can go there and essentially meet, but I don't think you can cross the similarity.
But one thing that you were mentioning, this the fact that there is the bifurcate horizon plays a very important role in this business. But in a traversable wormhole, you won't have a bifurcate horizon.
Right? Yes, exactly. So I'm not exactly sure what's going to happen there. I mean, there might be some other mechanism. I mean, okay, so what I'm trying to say is that, you know, this mechanism could be more general, and there could be something else that assumes this non-exact structure. I mean, so I think what we wanted to advocate in this paper was really that the fact that there's a non-exact symplectic form ensures this non-factorization. Okay, so now if you have a traversable wormhole, this mechanism can't be at this origin anymore, but maybe there's something else which takes this role of providing this non-exact symplectic form. But I agree, at the moment I'm not quite sure what that could be. So I just want to say, I think the mathematical structure could possibly be realized in different ways, which are also possible in traversable wormholes. But I agree that I don't know exactly how.
So you believe that this bifurcate horizon should not play too much of a role here?
Well, okay, no, in this construction is absolutely essential. I'm just saying, you know, maybe there's some other ways of realizing this mathematical structure independent of, but in this example, you know, this is where the non-exact symplectic form comes from. Yeah, no, so here.
Yeah, this is the reason why I asked the question, because in a traversable wormhole, you won't have this bifurcate.
I totally agree. I mean, in that sense, here it's absolutely crucial. Yes, I agree. But I'm just saying, you know, what compares to the quantum mechanical model is really this non-exact symplectic form.
Okay. Yeah.
And this is a mathematical concept, and maybe in a traversable wormhole, there's a different way of mathematically realizing non-exact symplectic form, but certainly not in this way as presented in this example.
Okay. So about the second part of your talk, I mean, there has been some works, right, on understanding, I think, the lengths of geodesics, how many geodics of a certain length can exist, or density of this. And this goes back to this work on Mirzakhani and all. So I don't know whether this is relevant to the large and light limit or.
The work by whom? Sorry, I didn't quite hear.
Mirzakhani, I mean, this is what actually, that was the original motivation for this studying what later has made connection to JT gravity partition.
Oh, really? Okay, I have to say.
But this is not for large N, right?
This is for.
Because you are all summing up all the genus diagrams essentially, so all possible contributions. You are talking about this Mirzakhani summations, right? So.
Yeah, but you can also. But you can also look into the genus, the leading genus contribution.
But what happens typically? I was just looking at it recently. What happens typically? So you have this contribution coming from this rho correlator, if you remember. And this in the leading order of 1 by n, if you expand, it gives you trivial result. It just becomes 1. So as far as I understand, probably if you consider large n limit, it will be it will not have non-trivial contributions. But maybe I'm wrong.
It sounds very interesting. I'm not quite sure either what you're talking about. Maybe sure we can explain to me at a later stage. But okay. Yeah, I mean the idea.
The original motivation was to see this ergodic behavior, to see how many.
I see.
How does the length of I don't know that I don't remember the full connection now.
Okay, yeah. I mean,
so there is a recent paper by Mezei and collaborators where they talk about how to define this length in principle, for example, in ADS2. So there they give the formula how you can write down these correlations, etc. And I was trying to work it out for that from that, the large leading large n behavior, and the conclusion I got is like the leading behavior doesn't have all the extra pieces, they just become trivial. But you can look at this recent paper by Mezei. They have a very in detailed description of this expansion.
Okay, I mean, I have to say, this is a purely, in this paper, we made a purely quantum mechanical analysis. Okay, so the only thing which was vaguely reminiscent of, I mean, the motivation, of course, was ADS-CFT. So that's why we took this large n limit, where large n means taking the number of components to infinity. Okay. And
exactly is the subtlety that you are mentioning? What is the order?
Yeah, exactly.
So I thought there's only one limit, only one parameter n that you're taking to infinity. So I didn't understand what is the other parameter.
The thing is that the problem is that in the algebra, okay, these vectors m and n, which are in this lattice here for the basis, okay, they also scale with n. Okay, so if n becomes larger, then this square becomes larger and larger. But so the claim that
so
we're making
depends on your cost function. Depends on
exactly. So the claim that we are making is that the larger, I mean, in the strict large n limit, the larger n, the less of these points inside contribute. So one has to be very careful about taking the right order of limits to really get. Okay, so these things in principle also scale like n. Okay, so and if this is of the same order as that, you cannot really expand the sign in the power series. And so we say there is a strict large n limit where you can, but then this means that the larger n, the less of these m and n vectors can contribute. Okay, so if this is the basis vectors of your basis. Essentially, in the strict large n limit, only the ones which are right in the middle still contribute. That's the claim that we're making. Yeah. And then this
And then what was the speciality about this basis? I didn't also quite get why this basis is so special.
The reason is that if you use this particular basis, then you can taking this particular limit. Then you get this algebra, which is the algebra of hydrodynamics on a torus.
Basically, okay. This is also the same as the algebra of this is how you see the isomorphism between is large SU and the area preserving diffeomorphism.
Yeah. Exactly. Okay. Yeah. Correct. Yes. That's the story. Yes. Okay. So the thing is that in this numerical computation where we still have finite values of n, we this picture we take account all these vectors essentially, and then the claim is that if we really take the strict large n limit, then there's going to be a drastic change, and then rather than looking at the manifold here, we will look at this area preserving diffeomorphisms, and then you just end up with this hydrodynamic behavior. But this really means that in the strict large n limit, there will be a majority of negatively curved directions. This is quite subtle. So the essential point is the large n limit has to be taken in such a way that when n is really, really big, only the vectors here in the middle will contribute. Yeah. That's the subtlety.
Okay, now thanks for the explanation.
Yeah, sorry, I was really fast about this. I'm a bit long. my presentation was a bit long. Yeah, but it's great that this became clear. Yeah. Okay, I should say there should be a revised version of the paper soon, because this new thing is not in the old version. And well, we had some discussions with various people about it, and it turned out that we have to be a little more careful in this original version of the paper. But I think now we solved the problem.
Okay, so let's have some more questions.
I have a very basic question. When you were talking about the quantum mechanical model and this non-factorizability, does it depend on the Berry phase thing? Is it dependent on?
Yeah, good question. Wait, let me share the screen one more time. So the point is, let me see to go to a good. So essentially, the Berry phase reflects a non-exact symplectic form. So maybe I should go to this picture. Okay, so the Berry phase is kind of the integral over the surface surrounding a singularity. Okay, so this means when there is a non-exact symplectic form, then we also get a non-zero Berry curvature, Berry phase, because essentially it's like doing an integral around a point charge in electrostatics. Okay, so if you calculate the flow of the field through a surface surrounding a point charge, then using Gauss's law you get something non-trivial, but there's definitely a singularity at this point. Okay, and this singularity at this point reflects in this non-exact symplectic form, and on the other hand, this non-exact symplectic form is also at the origin of this non-factorizability. Okay, so because if there is such a non-exact symplectic form, then the two Hilbert spaces of these two individual spins do not separate anymore. So it means that the ground state is not just in the product space of these two states, it's a genuine state somewhere in this blue region. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks.
I hope this is helpful. Yeah.
Any further questions? So we can also have some offline discussions. You want to ask something? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So when I look at the form of the Hamiltonian that you're using, it looks like the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, I think. It's S1 dot S2, and then when you add that that magnetic field term, right? It's like you're adding. Yeah. So it's like you're adding disorder.
Yes, exactly. Let me show it again to everybody. Yeah, here's the Hamiltonian. Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. So this is the Heisenberg Hamiltonian, right?
And yes, this is Heisenberg, and then we add this magnetic field. Okay. So So the magnetic field. Okay, and is exactly what creates this non-exact symplectic form. And so you can view this magnetic field as being the analog of this singularity in the one. So mathematically, the presence of this B field is exactly the same as this this point here, where the Killing vector jumps. Okay, so mathematically, I mean, traversing this region here is realized in the quantum mechanical model by this magnetic field.
Right. So what you just said brought another question to mind, is that if you take the magnetic field to zero, then in terms of this holographic picture, does that mean that you are talking about two disconnected boundaries?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, very good. So if we remove the magnetic field, it just means we remove the wormhole and then we just have two disconnected boundaries. Yeah, exactly. So in that case, everything factorizes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So as you increase the magnetic field from zero, you should have a transition from this disconnected geometry to a connected one, connected by this wormhole.
Yeah, okay. I wonder if we can do this in a smooth way, but okay.
Right. Whether it will be, right, it cannot be done.
Yeah.
And the second one, the question I had was, or comment was that, so the Heisenberg-Hamiltonian with disorder, right, for a many, many spin system. So instead of just two spins, if you take
that's an excellent question. Yeah, then you have a wormhole with different throats. Yeah, this should be possible. I mean, we haven't looked at this, but then just rather than just having two entangled spins, we would have say eight or entangled spins, and then we get a much more complicated wormhole with a throat structure. Yeah, I mean we would get generalizations of this picture here. Yeah. So this is a very good point, and we certainly think of realizing the same structure for these.
No, actually, that was not my point. But thanks for telling me about that. My point was that the Heisenberg-Hamiltonian with disorder also is used to study the scrambling or dynamics.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Yeah, you already mentioned this Wingel paper. I haven't thought about the connection to scrambling, but it's very interesting that you bring this up. And I think there's also uses there. That's a very good suggestion, and I need to think about it.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so maybe a short comment on those lines. So recently there's this other models like PSSY models for black hole evaporation, which are purely Euclidean, where you also have this non-factorized Hilbert spaces between the interior of the black hole, the so-called end of the world brain versus the reservoir states. And they also have a bifurcate horizon there. So in this picture, so I don't know whether this is sort of what you're saying is more general than a wormhole, for example.
Yes, I basically discussed this mathematical structure realizing non-factorizable Hilbert spaces. So I would hope there's many other examples where this can be realized.
Yeah, they actually also have a precise state written down. So
sorry, what is PSSY? What is
this so-called PSSY model, the Spennington's Schenker, Stanford.
We should also look at that. No, that's also a very, very good suggestion.
Because they have explicit, very explicit states written down about where one could look into such, perhaps. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's very interesting. Yeah. Okay, so good. So I think there are no further questions, so they're already being very long. So let's thank Johanna for this very beautiful talk.
Thanks for your interest, and I really enjoyed the discussion. So that brought up many, many interesting points. And I hope to be back in the not too distant future. But Ayan, we should also invite you for a seminar.
Thanks.
Maybe we can do that next term. I mean, I think our term ends now in February, and then the next one starts in April. So actually, Shovik is our seminar organizer. So, so we should get in touch with him. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Thank you very much, Johanna. For your interest. All the best to everybody. Thanks. Yeah. See you. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye.